First Presbyterian Church of Quincy. This morning we gather on the sixth Sunday of Pentecost, and it is a Sunday in summer in which we are discussing and thinking about the ways to love our neighbors as ourselves, and using the wisdom and the wisdom of Mr. Rogers' neighborhood to help us do that. So let's start this worship service with our church's mission statement, which you'll find on the screen. Please join me.
We are a Christian family of faith, empowered by the Holy Spirit, to glorify God, to proclaim His Word, and to grow together in Christ.
And please join me now for the call to worship. God's Word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path.
We gather around table, font, and pulpit to root ourselves in the sacred story and grow in faith.
God's teachings are our heritage. They bring joy to searching hearts.
We gather in God's presence to offer our thanks.
God the sower, we confess that we do not always live as people who obey your law. Sometimes we lack rocky ground.
We welcome your word when life is simple, but as soon as we face challenge, we forget your teachings and our faith withers.
Sometimes we are like a thicket full of thorns.
We clamor for more. Step over the needy. Your word is choked out of our hearts.
Forgive us, Lord. Let your spirit work within and among us. Make us good soil.
Weed out our resistance and water us with grace, that your word might grow within us and we might bear fruit for the sake of your kingdom.
And now in our silence, please hear our personal confessions. you may live. The steadfast love of the Lord never fails. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Now I've got a few announcements from the life of the church. As we've begun a couple weeks ago, we will continue to have Zoom worship at 9:30 a.m. during the summer. And in case you don't know, if you're watching this series for the first time, kind of joining us, Zoom worship is basically we gather together on a Zoom call in order to watch the recorded service together. So we get to hear each other's voices during a call and response portions of worship, which is a very special thing to do, especially during this shelter. And then right after that, at 10:30, is our Zoom coffee hour, where we gather together, see one another, and then we'll break into smaller groups so that we can have more natural conversation rather than trying to have 30 people talk about once and then we split into groups of five or so. So that's Sunday morning, 9:30 worship, 10:30 coffee hour. And then a special announcement tomorrow, Monday, July 13th, Jesse Killaway begins as our Director of Family Ministries. So please be praying for her, pray for our church, pray for our children and families as we enter into this next chapter of our church's life, and pray also just a prayer of thanksgiving that we have the ability to do this in the midst of a pandemic when our kids and families still, and maybe even more so, have need for these types of ministries and resources that Jesse. Please welcome her. The Presbytery of Boston, I think along with the national denomination, is doing a 21-day racial justice challenge. If you are interested in that, there is information from the Presbytery email. You can email me to ask for it. I forgot to add it to the Thursday email, so I'll add it next week. But that's something that if you're interested in digging into how God speaks into what's going on in our world right now, how we can think theologically and biblically about some of these things, it gives you articles to read and videos to watch and things like that every day. There's kind of a quick assignment for the next 2 weeks. And then we're thinking if there's enough interest, we might have a conversation over Zoom among people in our church who are interested to have a conversation about racial justice. So, if you're interested and you can't find any information, please let me know. And then Friday morning, 8 a.m., we have our weekly morning prayers. We're calling it prayer and coffee, so please join us for that Friday morning at 8 a.m. And then just a quick fun announcement. Thank you. Since I believe it was March 28th, or whatever that Saturday was, we have been recording services here in the sanctuary. And today we have Jim Mayer behind the camera, so I'm waving to Jim right now. And so Jim has stepped up to volunteer to run the sound and the video. But for the last, goodness, what has it been, like 12, 14 Saturdays, it's been Chris Barnett, who's been recording, who helped me learn how to edit videos on iMovie so that we can upload videos onto YouTube and all of that. So a huge thank you to Jim. And a huge thank you to Chris. Chris is the one who really gave us the ability to do this and to share our worship service with so many. And so I wanted to take advantage of the first Saturday that Chris was away to embarrass him on the video rather than in person and to just thank him for everything he's done for Alan and for me, for the singers, but also most importantly for our church family. So Chris, thank you for setting all this up. And now we will have our special music.
Yeah.
Today's first reading comes from the book of Jonah chapter 2. We're reading the entire chapter, which is verses 1 through 10. So Jonah 2. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God, from the belly of the fish, saying, I called to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol, I cried, and you heard my voice. You cast me into the deep, into the heart of the sea, and the floods surrounded me. All your waves and your billows passed over me. Then I said, I am driven away from your sight. How shall I look again upon your holy temple? The waters closed in over me. The deep surrounded me. Weeds were wrapped around my head at the root of the mountains. I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever, yet you brought up my life from the pit, O Lord, my God. As my life was ebbing away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you into your holy temple. Those who worship vain idols forsake their true loyalty, but cry with the voice of thanksgiving will sacrifice to you. What I vow, I will pay. Deliverance belongs to the Lord. Then the Lord spoke to the fish, and it spewed Jonah out upon the dry land. The second reading is from Matthew 6, verses 5 through 13. Matthew 6, 5 through 13. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites. For they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you are praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them. For your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then in this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Hey kids, it is time for the Moment with Children. Today we're talking about prayer. And we're talking about the importance of all of us, kids and adults, to find time in our days and in our lives to be quiet, to be still, to be alone with God. Because as far as we know, the best that we can tell based on scripture and based on people who have come before us who have known God really well, one of the best ways to connect with God is to be quiet and still and to be alone with God. In those times, we can feel God's presence. So today, we're talking about slowing down, being still. And when I was your age, that was really difficult for me. It might be the same way for you. And that's okay if it is. But here's what I want you to do. I want you to find a time in your day that you do something that you do every day. For example, brushing your teeth. Hopefully you're brushing your teeth in the morning and in the evening before going to bed. But how about this? How about when you're brushing your teeth at night, just say a simple prayer. God, thank you for my day. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for being with me. If we make that a pattern, we will grow closer to God. And throughout this whole summer, we're talking about how we need to love God and we need to love our neighbors as ourselves. In order to love our neighbors as ourselves, we need to recognize that God loves us. Times of prayer, times of quiet, even everyday things can help us remember that God loves us. So that's what I want you to remember. God loves you, and so we are called to love others. So will you join me in prayer? Dear God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for always being with me. Thank you for helping me love others. In Jesus' name, amen. Love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus tells us this in part 2 of the Great Commandment. After the command to love the Lord your God with everything you are, love your neighbor as yourself. Last week we began exploring what it means to love yourself in a way that lives up to this commandment. We learned that in order to love our neighbors as ourselves, we need to embrace and claim our core identities and it's rooted in God's love. We are God's beloved. So in order to love our neighbor as ourselves, we need to recognize that we ourselves are loved. Not in a self-serving, self-absorbed type of self-love, but in recognizing God's love for us. Today, we'll explore one of many ways to realize our belovedness, and thus take the first step in successfully loving our neighbors. I believe that we need to create patterns and rhythms of spiritual disciplines in our lives to embrace and claim our belovedness. And today we'll talk about the twin spiritual disciplines of solitude and prayer. Solitude and prayer. We'll focus more on the need for solitude and then the prayer that comes from that solitude. Now, there are several stories in the Bible of significant figures using solitude in order to connect with God through prayer. We see this in Daniel's life, we see it in Elijah's life. But today, I wanted to start with another prophet and another kind of solitude. Today's first reading is a prayer said in the midst of solitude by Jonah. But unlike those other prophets, Jonah's solitude was found in the belly of a great fish. Jonah was a prophet called by God to do the great Assyrian city of Nineveh. Famously, Jonah denied God's call and tried to flee from God's presence by getting onto a ship. So God sent a huge storm and the ship's crew threw Jonah overboard, and that's when the sea calmed. And then we see this interesting verb used in Jonah 1:17, just before today's first reading. But the Lord provided a large fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. So the Lord provided a large fish to swallow up Jonah. Provide sounds so positive, right? If we talk about God providing anything to Jonah, it would be something like a life raft or some sort of fishing device, not a giant sea creature to eat them in. Nevertheless, that's the verb used here, because it's not until Jonah is in the belly of the fish that he realizes how close to death he is, and he realizes that the only salvation from death is the Lord. The image of Jonah in the belly of the fish for 3 days is such a powerful one that Jesus used it to describe what his own death would be like, that Jesus would be in the belly of the earth for the same amount of time that Jonah was in the belly of the fish. But God provided life in the midst of death. Jesus was raised from the dead on the stood up alive on dry land on the third day. I start this sermon with the odd and fascinating story of Jonah because it is not until Jonah experienced solitude that he realized his dependence on God and on God's loving salvation for him. Now, it was a forced solitude, sure, but the other story by it says the Lord provided a fish to swallow him. And in the belly of this fish, Jonah finds that, oddly enough, he is in the presence of God and finds the words to express his gratitude and need for the Lord's life-giving power in the midst of death. I pray that you never find yourself in the belly of a great fish. Please do not go swimming off the coast of Cape Cod when there are great white shark sightings in search of some good fish belly solitude. I actually bring this story up because of its outlandishness. While the idea of being in the belly of a fish for 3 days and not being digested is outlandish enough, I want to talk about the way that God forced Jonah into solitude. Rarely does God force us into solitude. More often, we are invited to find solitude on our own, to intentionally seek it out. And that's where I want to shift this sermon to. Solitude is more than being alone because it is a time where we recognize God's presence with us. There is no loneliness in solitude. And in times of silence and solitude, we can hear God's small, still voice speaking to us. According to Peter Mallon, in the book that we studied last fall as a congregation, The Life of the Beloved, it is in this quiet place that we recognize that God loves us. The first step in loving our neighbor as ourselves. Now, it says this. The real work of prayer is to become silent and listen to the voice that says good things about me. To gently push aside and silence the many voices that question my goodness, and to trust that I will hear the voice of blessing. That work demands real effort. God speaks the blessing over us that we talked about last week. This is my child, the beloved, with whom I am well. Please, but we miss it when there's too much noise in our lives. Seeking out and finding solitude, as the Bible says, takes real effort. Now, Jesus is our model in seeking out regular solitude and prayer, and showing us that we need to be intentional in finding solitude and silence. Jesus often went off and by himself and prayed, left his disciples, found some place on the mountaintop, and just went there to be alone with God. And we find in Scripture that he wasn't just doing this to be a good model of prayer, even though he was doing that. He also did this to recharge. There's an interesting pattern in the Gospels, especially the Gospel of Luke, where Jesus sees that solitude and prayer either right before or right after significant events happen that cause turning points in Jesus' journey. For example, immediately after he feeds the 5,000 by multiplying bread and fish, he sends his disciples off on a boat and he goes to a mountain to pray by himself. And this, of course, sets up the scene where the disciples are on the boat and Jesus comes and walks on water to them. Other turning points in Jesus' story are marked by times of solitude immediately after choosing his disciples. Immediately before he asks his disciples who they say he is, and Peter proclaims that he is the Messiah. Immediately before the transfiguration. Immediately before teaching the Lord's Prayer. And famously, just before being arrested to be crucified, as Jesus spent the night praying alone Jesus intentionally sought out these regular periods of solitude and prayer. He didn't find himself in solitude like Jonah in the belly of the fish. He created a habit of it. He built rhythms of solitude and prayer into his busy life. But Jesus was not just a model of this type of prayer and solitude. He was also a teacher of it. Today's main reading is Jesus' teaching on prayer in the Sermon on the Mount. In this teaching, Jesus gave us some do's and some don'ts of prayer. Take care of the don'ts. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues on the street corners so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. When you are praying, do not keep up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. In other words, don't pray to impress others or to be seen by other people, and don't try to think that your rhetorical devices can convince God of anything. There's a piece of wisdom in ancient paganism called fatigue the gods, which was the idea that if you pray long enough, wisely enough, you could wear down the gods so that they would finally do what you want them to do. Our God is not like that. Now, here are the do's of praying that Jesus teaches us. When you pray, go into your room, shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. In other words, Jesus says, find solitude. Find solitude when you want to talk to God. Jesus holds up solitude as this place of prayer and simplicity, as a style of prayer, because he knows that we don't have the temptation to use prayer to impress others. And when we make prayer of any kind, any type of prayer, when we make it about others, we lose our focus on God. Now, once you find that solitude, Jesus says, keep the prayers simple. Jesus gives us the Lord's Prayer at the end of this teaching, a prayer that we pray every week, and one that gives us a pattern and a guideline for how to pray. Today, I just want to talk about the simplicity of the Lord's Prayer. Jesus tells us that we can allow our words to be few and to be simple. And there is great freedom in that. When we know that we don't need to say much, we have the desire to pray more. The easier something is, the more attainable something is, the more likely we're going to try to do it. The barrier to entry is very low in prayer to God. Simply find a quiet place and start talking to God. Pray how great God is. Pray how messed up you are. Pray about what's going on in your life. Pray for yourself. Pray for others. Be thankful. If we recognize that prayer is actually pretty simple, it becomes less intimidating, and it becomes more available for us to do on a regular basis. But if we're being honest, perhaps the biggest barrier to prayer is noise. And this is another reason that solitude and silence are so important. It's hard to find solitude. I recognize that. I feel that very much so in my own life. Our homes may be noisy and chaotic. Our work or our workplaces may be hectic. Our minds may be going a million miles an hour. Opening the newspapers or turning on cable news or going on Facebook shows that the world is a frenetic place, and that many in our world try to take advantage of that discord. We don't live in a time or a place or a culture that values solitude or sound. The irony is that a motorcycle keeps driven by a church and has its sound. We are addicted to constant stimuli. This has been highlighted throughout this pandemic season. Some of us have more opportunities for solitude because we can't see other people. And yet, we're not all taking advantage of it because Facebook usage is at the highest it's ever been in the history of Facebook. And the average weekly time spent on Netflix has increased 72% since this pandemic started. We fill our lives, consciously or unconsciously, with noise. And so we need to be intentional about solitude, silence, and the kind of prayer that comes out of that. Mr. Rogers can be our guide in this as well. Fred Rogers, in case you don't know, was the creator and star of a children's show called Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. He saw his role as a childhood educator as a divine call. In fact, the PCSA, our denomination, ordained him into this ministry. He preached the gospel through his words and deeds in the show. Once when I mentioned Fred Rogers in a sermon, the next week, Karen Thompson had dropped off a book into my mailbox on the faith of Mr. Rogers. The book is called The Simple Faith of Mr. Rogers, Spiritual Insights from the World's Most Beloved Neighbor. And this book has been a really helpful resource as I've been preparing this sermon series. And the author, Amy Hollinsworth, she became a friend and a pen pal of Fred Rogers, which she worked on as journalist. The first chapter of the book highlights the importance of slowing down and of silence. Mr. Rogers sought that in his life because he recognized that he needed to slow down and be silent to recognize God's presence and to pray. He also recognized that he needed to be intentional in the rhythms of his life in order to find that solitude and silence. So he would wake up every morning at 5 a.m. to pray silently. At 7:30, he would go to the local gym to swim laps, and just before he dove into the pool, he would sing Jubilate Deo, which is a Latin chant based on the first words of Psalm 100. And then while he was swimming, he would be praying, and he would emerge from the pool, he said, ready to engage today, as if newly baptized for that day. And then as he entered the studio, to fill Mr. Rogers, he would pray the same simple prayer every day. Dear God, let some word that is heard be yours. Is there any part of your daily routine that intentionally creates time and space for prayer? Do you wake up early to find that quiet place? Do you use mundane practices like swimming laps or washing dishes or brushing your teeth to say a quick prayer? Do you ask that your words and actions will highlight God in the world? And Mr. Rogers didn't just live this out. It was also an intentional value in his show. He taught children to slow down right as children's television was becoming more and more zany and frenetic. At the beginning of the show, you see this model of a suburban neighborhood, very calm and quiet, and then it enters the house and you see this streetlight flashing yellow, which is a symbol to slow down, unless it's from New England or California. And he enters the room in his work clothes while he's singing, "Won't You Be My Neighbor?" And while he's singing, he takes off his blazer and he puts it up so that he can get more comfortable. He sits down, he takes off his work shoes, and he puts on a pair of blue sneakers. He invited his viewers to enter into that time and space to be quieter, to be slower, and to be more intentional. And that's why television critics would say, this is awful television that you're doing, this is really boring, it's not going to keep anyone's attention. But he always kept that as a value in his show. And it paid off. One study showed that children who watched Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood had a higher tolerance of delay, meaning that children were more likely to be patient while waiting for materials or for their parents' attention than children who did not watch Mr. Rogers differently. Lord knows, we all need more tolerance of delay. How will we slow down and seek God's presence in silence and solitude? We have to be intentional. Our solitude is like other resources. We need to be intentional in using them and not just wait until they come to us. How much more money do you save when you put money away at the beginning of the month and wait until the end of the month to see how much is left to save? I think solitude is just like that. We need to be intentional in finding it. It won't find us like Jonah's solitude in the belly of the fish. We need to find it. And we need to be intentional about it. We need to build it into our schedules and into our rhythms and into our patterns. We can't wait for the world to slow down or to become quiet. It never will. And it's in that still, quiet place of solitude and silence that we can hear the still, quiet voice. I didn't know this before reading this book by Mr. Rogers, but he, like me, was a big fan of Henry Nouwen. Rogers wrote about Nouwen that even though most of the world knows Henry Bent by his words, Afton recognized his deepest respect for the still, small voice among the quiet of eternity. In order to hear that voice, God's voice from heaven that spoke Jesus' baptism that we talked about last week. This is my child, the beloved, with whom I am well pleased. In order to hear that voice in your life, you need to find his solitude and his silence. As Nouwen said, the work of prayer is simply to listen to that voice that blesses us and to ignore and push away the noise and the voices that say otherwise. So find time to be quiet. Find time to be in solitude. Find time for silence. So that in that time you can hear that voice telling you that you are beloved. And so that truly then, from that place, you can love your neighbor as yourself. Would you join me in prayer? Holy God, thank you for meeting us and being present to us at all times, but thank you especially for inviting us into quiet places to hear your voice, to be reminded of our place in your kingdom, to be reminded of our identity as the beloved. Lord, we recognize that it is only when we fully recognize our own love, that the love that you've given us, that we can then love others, and we recognize that God. Some of us have issues with that. Some of us have a hard time recognizing that we're loved. So Lord, I pray for each person hearing this today, and I pray this for myself as well, God, that you would help us to push away the voices that speak anything other than love into our lives, so that we can hear your voice of love. Once we hear that voice, God, help us to use that to love others, to love our neighbors as ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Eternal Spirit.
this journey now for the affirmation of faith as we confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now we join me for the prayers of the people. Oh God, help us find solitude and silence in our lives. Help us to hear Your voice, the voice that declares our belovedness. Help us to live out of our identity as the beloved, so that we can point others to their identities as the beloved. Help us love You with all that we are, and to love others as ourselves. Help us make solitude and prayer an intentional rhythm in our lives, so that we can use it both as a launching point and as a resting. We thank You that You are present to us in solitude and prayer. We thank You for Your still, small voice that returns us to our true selves and to You. We thank You for those who have gone ahead of us and taught us to pray. We use this time of prayer and silence to now lift up those in our church family seeking Your presence. We lift up to You the family and friends of Lori, Michael and Meg, Gwen, Rita, Priscilla, Susan, Donna, Ray, Ian, Terry, Patty, Bill and Melanie, Kayla, Jerry and Karen, Tahira, Kelly, Christina and family, Ron, Janice, Churchill, Pat, John Scott, House Rehabilitation and Nursing Center, and family and friends of Hollywood City. We lift them up to You. And Lord, we ask that You teach us to pray. We now lift up our voices to pray the prayer that Jesus used to teach us. Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom,
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance to you and give you peace. Go in peace in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.